Okay. Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will conclude our evidence taking on the inquiry into COVID-19 communication on public health information. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Marie Todd, Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Professor Linda Bald, Chief Social Policy Advisor, and Dr. Audrey McDougall, Chief Social Researcher. Welcome, everybody. Minister, would you like to make any short opening remarks before we move to questions?
Certainly. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to discuss the Scottish Government's communication of public health information. Communication was at the heart of our response to the pandemic. Our overarching communication aims were to reach the entire population of Scotland as many times as possible in the most cost-effective way, with accessible information that was easily understood and that motivated people to stay safe and to protect others. The challenges were significant in that the situation was changing constantly. Information was often complex and sensitive, and there were risks around overload and confusion, particularly when there were different measures and messaging from the UK government. Behavioural science was and continues to be central to our approach to all pandemic-related communications activity, alongside the significant behavioural asks identified by medical and other experts. Our understanding of the factors that inform behaviour change among the population has been essential in delivering effective public health messaging. As well as drawing on behavioural science best practice, we undertook our own research to strengthen our insights and understanding. Specifically, we sought to understand people's attitudes, awareness and motivations related to COVID. We also looked to identify barriers that people had to adopting important public health behaviours. We used that evidence to develop our messaging across a range of media channels to ensure that different audiences and population groups were reached. I want to turn briefly to the work that we did to drive vaccine uptake as one specific example of how we targeted our messages to help us to achieve the public health goals. We've ensured that all our COVID-19 vaccination communications are suitable for everyone in Scotland, with tailored messages where necessary to reach specific groups. We translated vaccine information into multiple languages and provided it in a range of formats on NHS Inform. We also developed a culturally sensitive vaccine explainer video, informed by insights from organisations representing various communities across the government. Equally importantly, we worked and continue to work with health boards and with other partners to encourage uptake, particularly where it's low in certain communities. Our approach is informed by the evidence, including Public Health Scotland's equality data, which gives a breakdown of vaccination uptake by ethnicity and also by deprivation. We have sought to build trust and remove barriers for people who might not otherwise take up the vaccination through a range of outreach activity and partnerships with local authorities, community and third sector organisations. The research published yesterday shows that people welcomed having a local and more flexible service when considering vaccination. Just as our approach to public communications was influenced by behavioural science and insight, our communications were also informed by the science of the pandemic and how to fight COVID. And that's meant rapid access to the evidence and expertise across a range of disciplines and organisations has been vital throughout. Just as the science behind our understanding of the pandemic constantly evolved, so too did our approach to how we commissioned and considered scientific advice. For example, we established the COVID-19 advisory group and subgroups, bringing together experts from a range of disciplines and organisations, including universities, Public Health Scotland, National Services Scotland and Scottish Government advisors. The Chief Medical Officer and Chief Scientific Advisor for Scotland also led a new network of our science and evidence-related chief advisors to share information across their specialisms. This delivered a holistic approach to the commissioning and coordination of scientific evidence. I look forward to this morning's discussion and I'm happy to answer questions from the committee.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm now going to turn to questions and we've got about 8 minutes each this morning, so we'll have to keep that in mind. If I may ask, just to get really where we're at the moment, we're aware that there's rising numbers and maybe 1 in 20 in Scotland currently have COVID. Are there any concerns with the latest spike and also that it's happened really early in the summer that I don't think anyone was expecting, and how's the pressure on the NHS currently? I don't know if this is for Professor Leach or
I think probably Professor Leach will be able to give you more data, but let me say we're watching closely the numbers. The numbers are rising. It was expected, actually. It's not unexpected. Okay. We do anticipate that we will be facing rising and waning cases of COVID for some years to come. My experts would tell us we're about halfway through this pandemic, not at the end of it, as some people would perceive. I'll let Professor Jason Leach give you much more detail.
Morning, everybody. Nice to be back. I thought we were done, but here we are. Here we are again. COVID recovery, and I'm on day 14 of recovering from COVID. It seems appropriate. So I am one of those statistics, and we are concerned. They have come at us 4 months, 5 months after the last variant. It's a pattern. We've had four versions of this. This is a sub-variant of Omicron and is still responding well to antivirals, still responding well to vaccines. People are not getting seriously unwell. But as the numbers rise, predictably, this room knows better than pretty much every room in the country, that means you get people in hospital and you eventually, unfortunately, get particularly the vulnerable dying. We've had 43 deaths in 7 days. We've got over 1,000 people in hospital with a COVID diagnosis. Of course, that's mixed in with other diagnoses, as we've talked many times here, but that makes things worse. We're hopeful as we look across Europe that this won't peak at the level we saw a few months ago when Omicron first hit us. Portugal, other countries would suggest that if you had a big Omicron wave, you perhaps don't get quite such a big Omicron 5 or 4 wave, but it's still difficult, and it's difficult for particularly those who are vulnerable. Our advice remains pretty much the same, but you can tell our tone has changed in the last few weeks, and it's about staying off if you're sick, whether that's college or work or school. Certainly reintroducing or thinking about face coverings, hand washing surfaces, all of those antiviral things. And of course, the key intervention remains vaccination. So if you haven't come, or if you're due a booster, if you think you've missed one, and we want to see you. So those are the key interventions. So we're concerned, but not panicking.
Thank you. Personally as well, my husband and my six-year-old currently have COVID as well. And I have to say, over the weekend, I only tested my six-year-old because my husband was so bad and she was totally fine, but she tested positive, but I had to keep her off school. And I was a bit confused about, should she go to school, should she not go to school? So I think everyone being with the restrictions for the past 2 years, we're sort of into this territory now that with rising numbers that I think there has to be guidance that's quite clear and as it evolves.
I agree that it's more complex now because we're treating your six-year-old as if she had flu or norovirus, and we're giving you quite a lot of the responsibility to manage that. So, and you're very informed. I mean, you chair the COVID recovery committee. So if you don't know what exactly the guidance is, then that gets more difficult. So let me be really clear. Our guidance is that your six-year-old doesn't need tested. Testing is optional. Mm-hmm. You can absolutely do that. But children who are sick should not go to school. They should stay off school. And as should your husband stay off work. As far as humanly possible, mm-hmm. until they feel better. Our kind of guidance in the round is 5 days full isolation. That's not the rules. Nobody's going to come and arrest you if you don't do that or check up on you. But our rough guidance now for the disease and everything we know about this disease is 5 days full isolation. And that gives us the kind of sweet spot for spread versus society reopening.
Okay. Brilliant, thank you. This inquiry is primarily about misinformation and disinformation, and to distinguish between the two, misinformation is consumed and spread inadvertently, and disinformation is some way deliberate. I do know that some countries are recognising that online media has become a new kind of warfare, and to tackle this and fake news, Finland, for example, has appointed a government ambassador specifically with the role to protect attacks on social cohesion and public trust back in 2019. As suggested by the RSE, does the Scottish Government think an independent fact-checking service should be established in Scotland?
So I think I'm going to let Professor Linda Bould say a little bit more about this, if you'd like to answer this.
Yeah, I participated in the Royal Society of Evidence Data and Evidence subgroup, just so you're aware of that. So that is a really important point, and it's absolutely essential that we tackle misinformation, and a whole variety of organisations have a role to play in that. I know you've heard from this committee, from Full Fact, who do play an important role, and of course they are not funded by the UK government. They're a UK organisation. They can't tailor all of what they do to the devolved nations, but they have an important role to play. So I think we need to do that, but I wouldn't say that we necessarily need to ask the Scottish government to fund a new body. I think it would be worth thinking what is the correct model and looking at international examples. But at the moment, we've done phenomenally well, actually, in Scotland in addressing that misinformation. We've had support from UK colleagues. So we also have the COVID Vaccine Security Group, which looks at online hate and misinformation, which I know and Professor Leach and I and others have had some engagement with them, and they played an important role. And there's a whole network of others outside of government, including actually MSPs, who are playing their part in responding to constituents' queries and making sure people have the right information. So I wouldn't jump to say government should fund a new body. I would ask, what are the gaps and what's the best model for Scotland?
Okay, thank you very much. I'll move on to Muir Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. A couple of issues I'd like to pursue. Minister, at the start, you talked about information being easy to understand. And I think that was true in parts. I think there were other parts where we struggled. I know the Scottish Government, early in the pandemic, produced the FACTS acronym. And I know Jason Leach will know what FACTS stands for, but I don't know many other people who do. Minister, do you know what FACTS stands for?
I certainly do. Of course I do. I'm the Public Health Minister.
Right, what is it then?
So FACTS is F, wear a face covering, A, avoid crowded spaces, C, clean your hands, T, 2 metre distance, S, self-isolate. I agree.
Very good.
I mean, I am very lousy. I am lousy at acronyms myself, I have to admit, and I find acronyms very hard. I can remember the acronym and I can remember the general meaning. Remembering what the individual instructions are is tricky. And I agree that there are finding that sweet spot of simple messaging is difficult. I know that the FACTS campaign in England, they went for
hands face.
Yeah. See, didn't remember that one. hands face face, which is a very simple 3-word message, which evident, you know, science would say is a really easy thing for people to remember and to understand. To be honest, though, either of those acronyms, if you asked people, would know that it meant that they had to do something. They may not remember the actuality of the phrases, but we see even now, 2.5 years into the pandemic, people really do know and understand the non-pharmaceutical interventions, which that particular piece of information was about, that they can deploy themselves to keep themselves and others safe. So we see now people talking about whether they should be wearing face coverings again. Everybody is washing and gelling their hands much more routinely than we did pre-pandemic. People know that keeping their distance is a way to keep themselves safe. People know that being outside is a way to keep themselves safe. People know that ventilation is a helpful thing. So there are lots of people know the behaviours they need to adopt to keep themselves safe. And I think that's the important measure of the success of these information campaigns.
And sorry, Jason Leach.
Only to say we've evaluated FACTS. You would expect, 83% of people said FACTS changed their behaviour. 83%. And remember the order in which these two campaigns came out. FACTS was first. Hands, face, space was second. Hands, face, space did run in Scotland. Nobody stopped it running. It was on TVs. It was on posters. So it added to what we already have. But to stop what we had done for a number of weeks, switch the whole population to a new campaign. Marketing thought about that. There are marketing experts who do that kind of conversation, and they thought that was counterproductive. They thought that was going to make it worse rather than better. And we had given our FACTS information to all of the 4 countries. Remember, Wales and Northern Ireland did other things of their own and all of that. So there were judgments to make in there about the timing of which marketing intervention you used. Fundamentally, they all pushed the population in the same direction.
Okay. Thanks. I was going to ask you about what follow-up we've done, but you've already answered that question for me. One of the other issues we've looked at is around trying to counter disinformation, which we were talking about earlier. And to put this in context, we've all seen with the vaccination programme, I mean, the vaccination programme has been a great success, there's no doubt about it, but there is still a segment of the population who are resistant to vaccines. And, you know, when we see the segmentation, quite a lot of that is amongst particular ethnic minority groups. The Polish community are one example of a group who, for whatever reason, cultural reasons, are resistant to taking up vaccines. Do you think enough was done in terms of public health messaging to try and counter disinformation about the impact of vaccination?
So again, I'll probably let Linda Bold say a little bit more than I do. I think that one of the challenges for government is that actually countering disinformation can validate it. So there are some suggestions that tackling it head on is more dangerous than leaving it to rumble and finding your own way to reach these groups who are susceptible to that. The other thing I would say is that actually the work that we did in terms of collecting ethnic data relating to the vaccination and actually being able to identify uptake and low uptake in particular communities enabled us then to change course and to do different things for those communities. So we had our general vaccine communication, which was targeted at the whole population, but we had specific ways of approaching and outreaching into those communities where uptake was low. An example of that would be, I just met last week with Gypsy Traveller community health workers, and in many ways that's a community that is hard to reach, or we make it difficult for them to engage with our healthcare system, and having these trusted members of their community helping to push public health messages within the community is a much more successful way of reaching that community and ensuring that we engage them with these healthy behaviours and these offers, and it's far more successful than a media campaign, for example. I'll let Linda say more.
I'll just make briefly 3 points. I think the first thing is that you need a multifaceted approach. So vaccine equity and gaps in uptake are an international phenomenon, as you know. And in Scotland, actually, we've done much better than most countries. I think you were given some evidence around the Eurosurveillance Journal article that showed that, you know, amongst European countries, we were second to top after Iceland in terms of our uptake and reducing deaths in the over 60s. But there are gaps. And the multifaceted approach actually, it doesn't work just for government to reach those groups, minority ethnic communities, others who don't necessarily trust the state the same way. You have to fund and support organisations to do this. And it's a shame you didn't hear from BMIS, who I think were going to give you evidence in one session. I think you would have heard a lot more evidence from them. Professor Leach, of course, spoke to Young Scot, to many different community groups himself, personally. So I think, you know, we would concede that of course, I'm sure it could have been perfect and better than it was, but a lot of efforts were made. I think the final point I would make, and I don't know whether Dr. McDougall wants to add, is that we had a lot of data underpinning where the gaps were, and then tried to use that data to inform approaches and who should be supported to reach out. And the final thing is, for me, it's not over. So it's an evergreen offer. Those vaccines are still there. They can still go into people's arms. And I have a lot of sympathy for the voices that say we should keep talking about this all the time so that we make sure that that message isn't lost. Did you want to add, Audrey?
So I'll just come in briefly and say that through the data that we collected both on vaccinations but also through our public polling data where we looked at people's attitudes to issues such as vaccinations, we were able to hone in on where we thought there were particular issues or particular problems and use that information then to create new campaigns, to have people like Jason and Linda and so go and speak to different groups, to provide funding for different groups to work with those groups that were more reluctant to uptake vaccination. And then again, through, you know, monitoring the rates and through our polling, we were able to see whether our efforts were making a difference. So this was something that was monitored very, very closely and we were very, very conscious of.
Okay. Thank you.
Alex Rowley, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Could I ask in terms of the vaccine? So I'm 58 years old. I've had my first two. I've had my first two, then my booster. There is all this talk about whether over 50s will need to get a booster coming into the winter. And And there's, well, what is the government's position, I suppose? Because if you're sitting there and you're thinking, well, that includes my age, am I at risk coming into the winter?
I think this is one of the challenges that we faced throughout the pandemic, is that we rely on expert advice. So for vaccines, we rely on the JCVI to give us advice on which groups should be targeted with the vaccine. And they can only work at a certain pace. And people are wanting to know now whether they are going to get a vaccine in the autumn. And often, you know, at the moment, the JCVI hasn't come out completely clearly about exactly. It said some of the population who is going to be eligible, but it hasn't made a final statement on who is going to be eligible. Scottish Government have largely followed JCVI advice because they are absolutely the experts on vaccination and will help us to make the most of that vaccine programme, which has been so transformative in this pandemic. Jason.
Oh, Minister's absolutely right. So here's where we are. So the Joint Committee on Vaccination has two steps. Interim advice, that's really to help us plan. Are we going to need 2 million doses or are we going to need 25 million doses? So their interim advice is get ready at least for the over 65s and everybody vulnerable over 12 and all health and social care workers. So we can then add that group up. So we know how many vaccinators we need. We know how much vaccine we need in rough terms. So that's what we're ready for. That's over 2 million doses for Scotland. So we're getting ready for that. They're then saying over the summer, we will look at vaccine waning. We'll look at variants. We'll look at what vaccines are available because there will probably be a new variant vaccine by the autumn, not with us now. So if we gave you a vaccine today, would it maybe be better to wait and give you the variant vaccine? We just don't know. The science isn't there yet. So over the summer, they've said they will continue to consider the science and then they will give us definitive autumn advice. My instinct, and that's all it is, I don't have an inroad into the Joint Committee more than anybody else, my instinct is they will reduce that age in the autumn. And you and I, because I'm 53, you and I will probably be in that group and it'll be a bit more like the flu group. But we don't know that for sure. And it will depend what happens to the disease, our response to the disease, but it will also depend what happens to the virus between now and the autumn. So I think they will move to a broader group in the next 3 or 4 months. Mm-hmm.
I think I saw, Professor Ball, that you were actually saying the Scottish Government should make representation on this and should be calling for all over 50s.
Well, I think there's always a confusion with how the media uses a sentence that you've expressed, as everybody in this... Yeah, exactly. Thank you. So I think I was very clear that my personal view is, given I'd seen some data, for example, from the US looking at the response to people in their 50s from an additional booster, that it would be likely that the JCVI would move in that direction, which is exactly what Professor Leach has said. So actually, we don't know what they will conclude, but it wouldn't surprise me if that is the decision that they take. But as Professor Leach says, having spoken to the vaccine team, they are actually preparing on the basis that that eligibility could be expanded. So they know they can press go if more of us, I'm in my 52, are on that list. So we wait to find out.
I won't possibly be eligible by this winter.
But that then brings you to the question in terms of... So I've, in this last couple of months, I've met trade unions in the public sector, I've met with nurses, been to health centres, and you come away from all them thinking these people have just run off their feet. You know, this has been a difficult time and people are... If we think as politicians, this recess day we want a rest, these guys are working, having to work through. And so then I think to myself, when I read the comments attributed to Professor Bald, I mean, so if suddenly there's going to be a vaccination in the over 50s and we need to get that done over a certain period of time, from what I saw the last time, staff were pulled out of lots of other bits of the NHS, and I'm not as sure that what damage that would do, given we're trying to focus on recovery. So are we preparing a plan for that, and how do we do that?
We are preparing a plan for that. And actually, we've learned a great deal over the course of the pandemic about how to do that in a way that doesn't impact on the rest of the NHS. And most NHS boards have built up vaccine teams and vaccine plans. And the way that vaccines are delivered, so people are finding over the last year or two, different rate in different places. They're getting their flu vaccine, for example, in a different way. It's moved largely out of GP practices and into health board centres. We are absolutely aware of the challenge for the teams on the ground. I mean, if I think back, you know, I'm a pharmacist by profession. If I think back to the course of this pandemic, I think about being hit by a virus that we didn't even know what it was, within a year having a vaccine. But I looked at that vaccine and I thought, oh my goodness, it comes in a multi-dose vial, it needs to be reconstituted, and good grief, it needs to be stored at minus 70 degrees. How on earth are we going to manage that logistically? How are we going to get that into people's arms? And that complexity has just continued to evolve. We now have multiple different vaccines. We have different ages eligible, which brings in different doses. We have different people in the community. You know, for example, people with very severe immunosuppression have a different, you know, are getting more vaccines than the general population because their immune response is suppressed. So that there is massive complexity in the vaccine programme, but actually we have done an amazing job in Scotland in rising to each and every one of those challenges. And I was in absolute awe last December. I mean, I remember when Omicron hit and we thought, like Brenda in that famous clip, not another one. And it just seemed incredible that we were facing in the depths of winter, when everybody was looking forward to Christmas together, to yet another variant, and that need to get boosted by the bells. Just the most phenomenal effort and response from our NHS, from our teams. And I helped out, I volunteered at a vaccine centre over last winter. You saw people coming out of retirement. I didn't actually go through the training to vaccinate. I was just helping out with managing crowds. You know, Jason has been vaccinating. We've had people from Public Health Scotland have come forward into the vaccinating team. It is just remarkable how our health professionals answered the call. It is also remarkable how our communities answered the call, because that vaccine doesn't work unless people get it into their arms. And it has just been the most remarkable. I mean, if I think about the levels of vaccination that we have achieved in Scotland, it is absolutely incredible for a vaccine that isn't mandatory, that's had to be delivered at pace in a changing environment for a brand new virus. It is really absolutely incredible. And there is no doubt that we have learned a great deal from each and every challenge that we faced throughout the pandemic.
So we're prepared, and we're prepared in a way that will not impact on other services within the NHS?
We're ready, but it's not a neutral act, Mr. Riley, so let's be clear. You can't use people twice. But we are able to vaccinate with whatever the Joint Committee tell us to vaccinate, and we'll be able to do it fast, so it will be a temporary measure. One of the things in the mix here is if we can do it with the flu vaccine, that makes it logistically so much easier for us, because we're already going to do over 55s, the vulnerable, whatever group that is. So that would make things a little bit easier for workforce. But we have a director of vaccination. We have leads for vaccination in all the boards. They know what's coming, roughly, and they will be ready for that. But let's be clear, we don't have an entirely new workforce or the funding for an entirely new temporary three-month workforce, and then they can all go back to hospitality. That's clearly not how it works. But we're as ready as we can be on a temporary vaccination basis, and we're going to do that on a rolling basis, probably at least once a year, maybe even twice a year.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, please.
Hey, thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, folks. Jason Leach, if you don't mind, I'm going to come back to you very quickly, because I'm slightly confused. Convener was talking about her daughter is positive but not sick. Should she go to school or not?
Yeah, she probably shouldn't go to school, but she shouldn't have been tested, according to the guidance. The test is optional, entirely optional. So you're allowed to test your child. I'm not suggesting you don't test your child. Now that you have that knowledge, I would probably keep that child off school for 5 days.
Now, if you're an adult who's tested positive but haven't got any effects, should you be going to work?
You shouldn't be going to work, no. Again, that's knowledge which you might not necessarily have. Remember, 30% of people with this disease are entirely asymptomatic.
Yeah.
So you probably won't have tested, unless you're a health and social care worker and you're still testing regularly, right, which is why we do that,
to try and take those positives out of the at-risk groups. But the present guidance is you do not need to test, because tests are no longer free. If tests are not free, you're being given tests, then you are asked to test health and social care workers, some other minority groups that we do particularly because they're high-risk areas. But in the main, you don't have to test. If you choose to test and you get the knowledge of a positive test, isolate for 5 days.
I can imagine the analytical discussion my wife and I will be having about this when I get home. However, I'm going to go back to the communication. The committee has heard that the Scottish Government's review of the advice of those in the highest risk list has not convinced people in the list that they are now at lower risk. And we heard from Dr. Sally Witcher last week. One of the things that struck, I think, all of us was the that feeling of we're getting left behind. And how do we make life more livable for people who, and again, I keep getting the wrong terminology. She was quite concerned about the fact that we were using the word vulnerable. And I'm not quite sure how we manage that language. How do we get people like Dr. Sally Witcher to feel that society is now safe for them?
I think Jason will probably give you a fuller accent answer on that, but you know, just that sensitivity around the word vulnerable indicates just how difficult it is to choose the right words to communicate risk to a population with different levels of susceptibility. But Jason.
Yeah, so it's difficult. I've watched that evidence back, and it is challenging and appropriately challenging for those of us in the public health communication space and in the decision-making. Let me tell you how it actually works. Whether you think that's right or not is a different question. There is an independent advisory group, UK-wide, chaired by one of Scotland's, let's call him Scotland's top doctor, a man called Professor Ian McInnes, who works at the University of Glasgow. And he chairs an independent advisory group that's basic exam question is who is at risk of this disease in the top end, and therefore who should get the antiviral drugs. Antiviral drugs are not a neutral act. They have side effects. They have other things going on. You can't just give them out in the high street. So therefore, if you're going to use those drugs, who are you going to give them to? Those who will benefit from them the most. And that's a clinical decision. That's not a political decision. That's rightly in the space of the senior clinicians across the UK who make those choices. A bit like the Joint Committee on Vaccination, boffins for vaccination. Ian's group is boffins for high risk. Now, the challenge here is that high risk group has changed. So let me use my own family as an illustration. Right at the beginning of this pandemic, my mum, 81 years old, COPD, otherwise well, in the high risk group. For sure. So she was told to shield. She was in that group. We thought she was at risk of this respiratory virus. 2022, June 2022, no longer in the clinically extremely vulnerable group, because we've learned so much about this disease that we know her COPD doesn't put her at extra risk. She doesn't become eligible for antivirals, except perhaps because of her age, not because of her pre-existing conditions. That's quite difficult to communicate with an individual who we've said, you need to stay in the house. You need to stop. You need to remove yourself from society because we think you might die of this. Now, 2 years later, we're saying, no, it's fine. You can go back to the theatre.
Yeah.
You can go back to church. You can do it. So that communication has been tricky. We've tried to do it in two ways. Professor Bald and I never turn down a media bid if it's coming. So we have pretty much done every single offer we've had to be on the TV or the radio to get that information across. That's one way we've done it. That has dried up a little, of course, as the world has moved on, as media bids move away. And we've written as often and as clearly as possible to those groups. And that's been difficult. People haven't always accepted the position of Ian McInnes's group with the vulnerable group. But I think I have to rely on the expertise and the clinical knowledge and the increasing and evolving science on who should get those drugs. We have massive trials. One is I've talked about it in this room before, the Panoramic study, which takes big groups of people, we give them a drug, we compare them to those who don't get it, and we watch the results. That's how we know dexamethasone works in intensive care. It's how we know some of the more far fetch the drugs don't work, and we continue to do that for groups with antiviral drugs, and it teaches us every single day. And Ian's group, with Scottish and UK-wide representation, decides who is in that vulnerable group. That's how it works.
Yep, please.
So Dr. Witcher also made a different set of points, as you know, about environments.
Yes.
I think what she, her view, and that is shared by many, is that we need to change our environments across Scotland to reduce the risk of infection in a range of settings. And that's a really valid point. And of course, we are trying to do that. It can't be done quickly. So just to highlight a couple of developments that MSPs are aware of, recently I think Deputy First Minister has written around the fact that we had the short life ventilation working group, certainly the advisory subgroups I chaired on schools and on universities, heard from that group and learned from them and took steps around adaptations in those settings, much more to do. There's also the COVID safety signage scheme, which is now being piloted.
Yeah. And you've obviously read my notes.
Okay, I know, I haven't actually. My eyesight doesn't stretch that far. But,
that's because you're in your 50s.
Exactly, yeah, that's true. That is a very good point. No, it's true. I didn't. The reading glasses are in the bag. No. So places like Orkney Council and other places will be piloting that. Now, that does not go as far as colleagues and Dr. Witcher would like to see. But I think that longer-term adaptation is something we really are committed to, you know, but it's not going to happen overnight. I don't know whether you want to add to that, Minister.
No, that's fine.
Okay. Yeah, she's used the inclusive new normal, the hashtag inclusive new normal, and I presume that what we're looking at is exactly what you've just outlined, how we make public spaces safer, how we make theatres safer, and all of that work is ongoing. But as you say, it's just going to take more time than, and until that's done, until people feel that that's done, then they still feel like they are in that forgotten about category. There's not really very much we can do about that until we move on, is there?
So I think people should have confidence that that work is ongoing. It can't happen overnight. Nobody has a magic wand, but it is ongoing. I suppose the thing to try to communicate is that we are in a very different place than we were at the start of the pandemic. We have a really, really effective vaccine. We have a vaccine which, and I think it's probably, I mean, I'm a pharmacist. It is perhaps a little hard for everybody to understand that despite the fact that it doesn't prevent transmission, that vaccine is really, really effective. So it doesn't stop you catching the illness, but it has taken the death out of it. It's taken the serious illness out of it. We're not seeing the level of hospitalisation that we had. We are certainly not seeing the level of mortality that we had. So the vaccine is incredibly effective and has transformed the situation. The people who are not responding well to the vaccine are largely people who have immune systems that aren't making those antibodies when they're vaccinated. So that's why the evolution of the groups who are particularly at risk. That's why people who were at risk pre-vaccine, or we thought they were at risk pre-vaccine, people with COPD, for example, are less likely to be in those high-risk groups now because their immune systems work well. Less effective at 81, but they're not immunosuppressed in the same way as people who have had organ transplants are, for example. The other tool that we have in the box, which has just transformed things, are these medications, these antiviral medications. And we have in place people who are eligible for those medications, know who they are, and they know how to get them. And actually, wherever they are in the country, they know there's information on NHS Inform. They can find the phone number of their health board and telephone them if they find that they test positive, as long as they are in that eligible group. And within the first 5 days of illness, they can get these antiviral drugs. And they have also transformed. So even for the people for whom the vaccine we know is less effective, we have treatments that also can reduce the risks from this virus. So we're not in the same situation that we were in before. And none of us have forgotten about those people who are so severely impacted. I mean, I think one of the challenges is communicating to that particular group just how important it was for them to protect themselves and keep safe. Using words like vulnerable make you feel ill and vulnerable. It had to be done, it had to be communicated that way, and it's, you know, there's a tension that when I used to work in mental health, I had to work really hard with the patients that I worked with to help them to understand that they were ill. And once they understood that they were ill, they were motivated to take their medication. But actually they felt it's a good thing if we feel healthy. It's a healthy thing to feel healthy. And that understanding that you're not healthy, that you are at risk or that you are vulnerable, has quite a profound impact on people. And what we find is that people are struggling a little bit to recover from that feeling of vulnerability, which is perfectly understandable. I think actually all of us are feeling, every human being in Scotland has felt more vulnerable than they did before, largely. Yeah. And it is quite hard to remind yourself that the situation today is very different from the situation that we faced in March 2020.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move to Brian Mitchell, please?
Good morning, panel. Just to go back to the way in which things were communicated, I think the government or governments, certainly UK, used the term follow the science. And I think, you know, generally there'd be a lot of comfort to be had from the general population that there was reason for us asking them to do taking such extreme measures to look after the public health. So follow the science was, you know, I think was well recognised as a good term. However, do you think we did enough to explain to people what follow the science actually means? Because of course the science is such a moving picture, and you know, for the simple example, we had the First Minister and the Prime Minister early on in the pandemic standing up saying, there's no evidence to say that face mask will make any difference, until the science said it did make a difference. Do you think there's enough, you know, the follow the science was a great message. Did we do enough to explain what that actually meant?
So it's challenging. As a scientist myself, I have a real passion for this. I think that our generally in our population, we don't have a great understanding of science. Science isn't black and white. Mm. It's not, you know, it doesn't tell you what's right and what's wrong. What it does is help you to answer questions. It's a way of seeking a way forward. All it does is inform your decision making, rather than telling you in a black and white way, this is what you've got to do. There is still always judgment in science. Follow the evidence base is slightly less catchy, and that might have helped people to understand that that might be a changing feast. But I think there aren't many positives to come from the pandemic. It's been the most testing time for the whole population. But if I'm honest, I think that we've seen a far greater understanding of science in our population, which I think will stand us in good stead. We've seen a great deal of health literacy and risk assessment going on. So people have, you know, gone on to Public Health Scotland and found the data for their local area and made their, and that has informed their own risk assessment of what they might need to do. I think that's a really healthy thing. I think that's a really positive thing to come out of the pandemic. The other thing I would say is I've seen a really vast improvement. As somebody who used to yell regularly at the television, I've seen a real vast improvement in our scientific reporting and our medical reporting. When I worked as a pharmacist, I used to regularly be frustrated at the way that significant clinical trials were communicated to the general population. I think we've seen that happen in a far better way. We've seen our journalists who are involved with reporting science and medicine really step up to the task and do a pretty good job of communicating quite complicated things to a population who generally aren't scientists. I don't know if either of my colleagues want to add.
I'll add something. So it's difficult. I mean, we have the structures to take in the science and to inform policy decisions. We had the Chief Medical Officer's Advisory Group. We had SAGE, which some of the same people sat on. We had the subgroups on nosocomial infection, testing, the two that I chaired. So we had all those structures. But the problem is that the science is not always definitive. So I'll just give you some specific examples that you've, I think, discussed in this committee already. One of the members raised pregnancy. in a previous meeting around the very early days of the vaccines because pregnant women weren't involved in the trials, and there was a little bit of confusion around that and then more clarity. We didn't know as much as we do now at the beginning about airborne transmission. We didn't know as much as we do now about asymptomatic transmission, and then you raised the issue around face coverings. So there wasn't always a single truth to communicate to policymakers. I think it became much easier because we just got huge amounts of research. I mean, countries around the world threw resources at that, and it became easier. But I think in the early months, to say there was a single science was
tough. I think that's my point, though. It's follow the science, I think, was a good message. But then I don't think we communicated properly what follow the science meant, and that science would continually evolve. We didn't communicate that particular message out to the general public. So what they saw was, I need to do this, but now I need to do this. Whereas I think, you know, what I'm trying to push at here is, should we have gone further than that and said, follow the science as it currently says, and it will evolve as we learn more about this virus, probably was
behaviourally trying to communicate uncertainty is very challenging. I think if you look at things like the COVID social study and the trust that was in Scotland for the communication, it was very high. It was higher than elsewhere in the UK. So it's never going to be perfect, but you're right. Communicating uncertainty is a very challenging thing. Mm. And, you know, whether it was perfect or not, I don't know. I don't know whether anybody else wants
to. I completely agree. The science changed sometimes during TV interviews. I mean, literally during the interview, the science would change. So somebody would text me and say, there's been a study in pregnant women, the vaccine is safe, for example, as literal as that, while you're on TV. So I think Linda and others have been exemplars in that public communication at a level we've never seen in our lifetime, trying to get that science over, saying this is today's science. But we were literally moving. We were literally doing the science in real time. Normally, we would have medical journals and scientific journals that we could consider over a few months and then think about in giving that to the public 6 months from now. But we didn't. We didn't have that luxury. We had to do it in real time. And we tried. Whether you think we did that well enough or not is a different question.
There is no criticism here whatsoever. Just trying to stamp whether or not, you know, it's easy to look back in 2020. If we had to go through it again, would we have been altered the way in which...
The only other thing I would add is that it depends where you get your information from. So if you get your information from mainstream public service broadcasters, I think it was good. I think it was well presented. I think Fergus Walsh, for example, is an obvious example of somebody who did the trials really well. If you get your information from Twitter, frankly, you need to look elsewhere.
Yeah, indeed. Can I just one more thing I was going to raise, something I'd never thought I would be raising, but as a constituent has brought this to my attention, I think, and it speaks to the communication. This happens to be a nurse of 26 years' experience who raised the issue of VITT. I have to say this, I suppose, vaccine-induced thrombocytopenia and thrombosis, did I do that right?
Yes.
I've been practising that for about a week. And I think it's now acknowledged that as a condition, and nice published guidelines, clinical guidelines for it. And her absolute belief that vaccinations, etc., were absolutely the way to go. However, I was surprised to hear that there's about 220 confirmed cases, 78 fatalities, 69 probable cases and 70 possible cases. And as she says, you know, these are relatively very small numbers compared to the vaccine. Nonetheless, these are people who have a condition, have reacted to a delivery of a multiple doses of vaccine in a relatively short time. So there was inevitably going to be some medical and statistical harm done. What she was saying is these are people who have had an adverse reaction to the vaccine and were kind of vilified and pushed away and not listened to at the time and have a clinical need. In terms of the way in which we communicated, her question is, did we communicate the very small potential risk there was with the vaccine? And by not doing that, did we create a vulnerability in those few people who had an adverse reaction?
I'm sure Jason would want to say a little bit more about this, but with any vaccine programme, that, you know, and with any vaccination, there will be a balance of risks and benefits. Mm-hmm. I suppose we've seen that very clearly played out as the JCVI gathered together the evidence for vaccinating children, where they felt that the benefit-risk balance was a little bit different. And, you know, you need to take into account which population you're aiming your vaccine at. You know, some people, it'll be a complete no-brainer, because they will be particularly at risk from the consequences of that virus. For others, it will be a question of considering their own vulnerability and how much it helps the population in order for them to be vaccinated. So these aren't clear-cut decisions. Vaccines always carry risks. It's always a very small number of people who suffer adverse side effects. It is often the case that you can't predict who is going to suffer those adverse side effects. If you could predict it, you would be able to take measures to avoid it. And with a vaccine programme of the scale of this vaccine programme, where you're targeting pretty much the entire population, there are likely to be some people who suffer adverse events, but the benefits on a population level still outweigh the risks, and I think that's a really important thing to communicate. One of the challenges is there were some side effects which might have been more predictable, and there were people who thought that they perhaps shouldn't have the vaccine. So there was the question around people with allergies or allergic responses to vaccines, and it's always, if you've had an anaphylaxis in the past, it's very frightening to consider that you accept a vaccine where there is potentially a risk of allergy, and helping to reassure those individuals and to risk assess on an individual basis whether they were at particular risk from this vaccine or not is a difficult thing to communicate, and you couldn't communicate that at a population level. That had to be an individual discussion between clinician and patient at the time of vaccination.
I think that the question I'm really asking here is around that communication, and should we have, if we had communicated, you know, discussed the potential risk more, would that have prevented more people getting vaccinated?
No, opposite. Would it, well, I disagree with your premise entirely.
It's not a premise, it's a question.
Okay, well, the answer to your question is no. The Lancet has just published the first global study into vaccination lives saved. And it's not complete, because it can't be complete. It suggests 20 million lives have been saved in the last year. 20 million. It's quite remarkable. We think 18 million have died of the disease. Your biggest risk for blood clots is COVID. The number of people who have had blood clots and die because of COVID is off the scale higher than those who have had vaccination. Now, we've also adjusted the vaccination programme in light of some side effects which developed. I don't recognise these numbers that you read out. They're certainly not Scottish numbers. So those numbers you read out would suggest that we should look at that. And we have. Every time there are large-scale side effects from vaccination, we move. Right at the beginning, you'll remember we adjusted Pfizer because we had some allergy. Later on, we had some young men with blood clots. We adjusted which vaccine they got, the order in which they got them, when we were going to do them. So we have moved along the line, along the road of vaccination, and changed it as we've gone. But let's be very clear to the public. The thing you can do to protect yourself from this disease, including the blood clots you get from this disease, is to get vaccinated.
I think you missed my point, Mr. Leach, I think.
Sorry. Time's moving on. John Mason, please.
I appreciate that. Thanks, Convener. But actually, to follow the same theme, I mean, as you said, it's important where we get our information from, and Twitter is not the most reliable source, but there is quite a lot of discussion on Twitter, and that 20 million figure has been very useful, and I've been quoting it quite a lot myself. So, I mean, you said you disagreed, Mr. Leacher, with Brian Whittle as to the numbers. Can you give us any figure, you know, how many people do have a serious reaction side effects to the vaccines? I mean, I got a sore arm, I didn't feel well for 24 hours, that's pretty common. But people are quoting this yellow card system and all sorts of things. I mean, you said way off the scale. Are there definite figures about, you know, how many people have actually either died from the vaccine directly or indirectly or had a serious injury?
Yes, there are. They're on the MHRA website. I don't have them off the top of my head. I'm happy to look and send you more details, but you'll be able to find it yourself. It's tiny numbers, and then you have the fundamental and unsatisfactory answer, which is you can't always relate vaccine to outcome. Because inevitably, when you vaccinate a whole world, some people have a stroke the next day. Some people fall under a bus the next day. Neither related to the vaccine. So when you vaccinate billions of people, you inevitably get people who, in time order, end up with whatever happens to them. There are, of course, some known side effects of vaccines, sore arms, some allergy. There are some blood clots. That's absolutely true. And we think they're tiny numbers. And we think when we adjust the vaccine we give, we can reduce that number even further. And that's what we've done.
I mean, looking forward then rather than back and, working with the MHRA and so on, are there things we can do in future? Because science is moving on. And as I understand it, we produce these vaccines much quicker than we normally would. And that might happen again in the future. But that in itself, gave people a wee bit of a lack of confidence. Is that just inevitable, or do you think maybe we could do something in future?
I mean, I think it's inevitable that in a global pandemic, people will feel a little bit frightened and lack confidence, frankly. I think that the vaccines, the thing to communicate about how the vaccines were developed is that no stages in development were skipped. What happened was that governments underwrote the development and took the risk out of it for drug companies so that the trials that are required, the different phases of clinical trials, happened simultaneously instead of one after the other. Normally in drug development, these things take up to 10 years because an early trial happens, followed with a trial in humans and a trial for efficacy and all of that. And that happens one after the other, and they assess in between each stage whether they think they've got a vaccine that's going to work. Because we needed the vaccine so quickly, all of that was risk, and drug companies don't want to run the risk of putting a lot of money into something that isn't going to work. So the risk was largely underwritten by governments, and those trials were able to happen simultaneously. No steps were skipped. And it's really important that the population understand that. Then the yellow card surveillance. I mean, there are surveillance schemes all around the world. The yellow card surveillance one is the one that's run by the MHRA. So post-marketing surveillance is absolutely vital when any new drug is developed and used in a population. And that gives us information. As Jason says, it doesn't establish causality, but you get information on a population-wide level of what happens, what sort of things might happen when a new drug is used. When new drugs are launched into the population, every single side effect is reported on yellow card, and there's ways the individuals themselves can report, do a yellow card report, their medical team can do it. So there's loads of routes into that. And what happens is you gather a huge amount of information. What we've seen is that level of analysis of that information has happened at absolutely remarkable pace. And if you think this is happening all around the world as well, the whole world is being vaccinated, and we are learning globally from all of this global data. We are getting a really good idea of how to use these vaccines safely and effectively in the population. I mean, I think the example that Linda gave of the changing picture for women who were pregnant is a really good example of understanding that rarely are drugs tested in pregnant women for very obvious reasons. So when new drugs are launched, it's very difficult to say definitively that they are safe in pregnant women. But they were used worldwide, and millions of pregnant women have now had those vaccines, and that data is collected and analysed and used to refine the offer and make it even safer and more effective as we go on. It's really a remarkable. I hope this level of collaboration globally, scientifically, continues beyond this particular emergency.
Okay, to move to a slightly different area, we've taken a bit of evidence as to who people trust for information during the committee, and especially that's the point about the Polish community and other ethnic minorities being a little bit reticent and in some cases receiving information from the government of the home country or wherever, be that Poland or Africa or Pakistan or wherever. But I was interested in Public Health Scotland, and they submitted a paper and they were saying the most trusted are NHS, Public Health Scotland, health professionals and the government, which is encouraging. But less trusted were social media, community leaders, religious leaders and news media, which did strike me as interesting because I think we had thought that if we could go to community leaders for some of the ethnic minority groups, they would be more trusted. But Public Health Scotland seemed to be seeing something different. So in that area as to who's trusted and who's not, have you any thoughts on that or thoughts going forward?
Yep, that'd be great.
Do you want me to start with that? So I think that's probably a blanket response. Community leaders will have been a category in their survey. There's a lot of evidence, including from international studies around medicines and vaccine hesitancy, that if there are community leaders that are from particular areas that are trusted, whether there be somebody, for example, from the faith community or somebody who's working, say, with women in an area, it's about people that they know and they trust. So I wouldn't assume that all community leaders are trustworthy, but I think there's a lot of literature to suggest that if you get to the right ones, actually they are the best ones to pass on the message. The other source of data is the Ipsos Mori Veracity Index, which I think probably chimes with some of what Public Scotland have found. But just to respond to your specific question.
That's right. Did Dr. McDougal want to say something?
No, I mean, it's just to say that all the evidence that we've seen certainly would support the general evidence that PHS are putting forward, but it is noticeable the very high levels of trust that we saw among the public for people in the health professions, for scientists, and indeed for government. And there was absolutely no doubt. And that has changed from pre-pandemic. Pre-pandemic, I don't think we would have seen quite that same level of trust necessarily. In the science profession, for example, people would just have been less aware of the role of scientists and what they did. And we saw that really rise throughout the course of the pandemic. And we saw, as I say, quite encouragingly, trust in government maintained at a very, very high level as well. So in terms of that general communication of messages, every time we polled, people had a very strong level of trust in government as a source of information and as a trusting in government to do the right thing.
Thanks very much. And my final point, I mean, we had the RSE early on giving us advice, Royal Society of Edinburgh, and there was a few things they were quite keen on, certainly more science education to try and get the whole population thinking more scientifically, and also the idea of an independent fact-checking service. I mean, are you positive towards these suggestions?
So I think Linda Bold's already talked about the independent fact-checking service. I would love it if children were more interested in science. And I think we are seeing that. People are inspired by folk like Linda and Jason who have been on our television.
That's not true.
Who have been on our television screens for so long, helping to guide us through this really challenging time. And I think that there is definitely more interest in science amongst the population and amongst the young population. And I can't tell, I mean, I would be delighted if that was an outcome from this pandemic, that more people went into scientific disciplines. There are lots of them, and it would be a great thing. I mean, there are very few of us with science degrees in politics, for example, and I know that that's been mentioned many times since I came into politics. There are just a handful in those 129 MPs with a science background, and actually it would be quite a useful thing if more people had that understanding, that rigour, that ability to analyse information, put it together, that ability to cope with grey areas, which is inevitably, you know, to make good decisions despite the uncertainty and the gaps is absolutely a useful skill in government. So more science, please, I think.
Okay, thanks so much, Minister. So we've got the message, more scientists, fewer lawyers, and the accountants are just about right.
I think Audrey is keen to contribute data scientist.
Just wanted to make a quick point, which I found really encouraging, actually. Over the course of the pandemic, as you might imagine, we got a lot of correspondence from the general public, an enormous amount of correspondence from the general public. But my team, who are the team who have been looking at collating science evidence and data, we got a huge amount of people actually engaging with us on an engagement around the science and the evidence to discuss it with us. People actually emailing us, asking us to look at some of the calculations they've done. Does that look right? How does that fit with what other people have done? This is a microcosm, but this has never happened before, when we've had so many members of the general public just get in touch to actually discuss the science, discuss the evidence, and try and work it out for themselves. And I found that immensely encouraging. It made me think that there is a real hunger in the population and people in the population who want to engage and want to be able to do this. So I would feel very positive about that going forward.
Absolutely. And you've just reminded me I should mention Travelling Tappy, who
yes,
this absolutely outstanding citizen science,
yeah,
wasn't it,
absolutely,
who you put together. And so not all sites on social media are not worth looking at. Travelling Tabby was absolutely brilliant at analysing the data and presenting it in a way that was understandable to the population. Remarkable work from a university student, and he's been rightly lauded for it. But yeah, more of that would be great.
Thank you very much. I'm conscious of time. We've gone slightly over, but that concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Minister. And I'd like to thank the Minister and her supporting officials for their attendance this morning. Thank you. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. We've got subordinate legislation. I now move to the second agenda item, which is consideration of the negative instrument listed on the agenda. A motion to annul the instrument has not been lodged. Does any member have any comments to make on this instrument? No? Okay. Members therefore content to agree that we have no recommendations to make on this instrument?
Agreed.
Thank you. We are agreed not to make any recommendations on this instrument, and that concludes our consideration of this agenda item. This is our last meeting before the summer recess period, and the committee's next meeting will be on Thursday, the 8th of September. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I now move this meeting into private.